Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today, in the LifeCell webinar, I'm going to discuss a little bit about Down syndrome screening. We all do Down syndrome screening. We are acquainted with it. Now, the screen comes as positive, which is called T21 screen positive. What to do next? This is the object, this is the subject of today's discussion. I'm going to discuss and share some of the slides and talk you through it and answer some questions, relevant questions, if any, at the end of the presentation. Down syndrome is one of the very important abnormalities that the child is born with. These Down syndrome babies are basically chubby, smiling, lovable babies, but unfortunately, they're mentally retarded and quite challenging to bring up. Now, what happens in Down's baby is they have an extra chromosome in all their cells, and the extra chromosome is chromosome number 21, and therefore this is called trisomy 21 as well. The birth prevalence of Down syndrome is around 1 in 700 to 1 in 800. Survival to term is around 65%. And because these Down children, babies, survive till around 40 or 45 years of age, they are quite challenging to be in the society. The varieties of Down syndrome are pure non-disjunction variety, which is purely accidental, you might say, at the time of meiosis. There can be mosaic Downs, which means that the extra chromosome is not present in all the cells of the body. It could be 10%, 20%, depending on the percentage of mosaicism, the phenotype changes. And usually mosaicism less than 10% are not very clinically significant. And therefore, what should be done with such findings and such reports is open to debate. There is another type of Downs, which is translocation Downs, and that is 1421 translocation most commonly. And the varieties of Down syndrome are, as I said, pure non-disjunction, mosaic Down and translocation Downs. The extra chromosome 21 that comes is maternal origin in 88% of cases, paternal origin in 9% of cases, and post-zygotic mitosis in 3% of cases. Now, why do we do a screening test at all? And why not go for a diagnostic test straight away? Diagnostic tests are invasive, like chorionic villus sampling, which is the miscarriage rate of around 1%. You have amniocentesis, where the miscarriage rate is around 3%. And therefore, there is no way that we can advise diagnostic tests in all patients in order to pick up Downs. Therefore, we do a screening test. The whole idea of doing a screening test is to first divide them into screen negative and screen positive. In screen negative patients, we usually counsel and continue them with the pregnancy, with the usual antenatal care. And in screen positive women, we counsel and we want to confirm whether it's actually Downs or not. What are the current screening protocols in vogue? If a woman has a history of previous Down syndrome baby, this itself is enough a screening test to carry on with a confirmatory test like amniocentesis. Because whatever may be the biochemical screening report, if we put in a factor of a previous Down syndrome baby, automatically the risk is increased to around 10 times, and therefore any biochemical result will become positive anyway. Then the other screening protocol, which is in vogue very much and gaining acceptance, is first trimester combined screening, which is called FTS, or a combined screening, where we do nuchal translucency and a double marker test at the same time on the same day with a CRL measurement. And then we have another type of screening, which is the second trimester quadruple marker screening, which is called a quadruple test. We should not be doing the first trimester, second trimester triple test. Non-invasive prenatal screening is another one, which is called NIPS. This is actually a genetic screening test. Still is in the level of a screening test only. And the newly introduced screening tests are first trimester quadruple test and penta screening. So therefore, we have several types of current available screening protocols. It is also important for us to understand the screening protocols which are better avoided. Like age alone as a method of screening above the age of 35 is not usually recommended, because if we follow that, only we pick up around 30% of Downs, and therefore this has been superseded by the different types of biochemical screening that we are discussing. Nuchal translucency alone again came up with a bang as a method of screening for Down syndrome, but now again has been superseded by the FTS, where we do nuchal translucency as well as PAPI and beta HCG. Doing biochemistry alone, which is called the double test, without doing NT is also not quite acceptable one, especially in places where facilities exist. Blank screen. Okay, and then another screening protocol which is better avoided is the triple test, as we have said before, because it is not very sensitive enough and it has been superseded by the quadruple test. The other one which is better avoided is the integrated screening, though the SURUS trial has shown that this has the maximum sensitivity and specificity, but because of logistic problem, this is something which is not very much advocated. Now suppose we do a screening test and the report comes as screen negative. What does it mean? It means only that the pregnancy or the fetus is at a low risk of having a Down syndrome. But low risk is not zero risk. And there is always a possibility that even after a low risk, there is a remote possibility that Down syndrome baby may be born. But fortunately, such false negative reports are rare. But once in a while, we do get reports like you see in the newspaper that after doing a screening test, it has been positive for Downs. Therefore, we should never reassure a patient and always say low risk is zero risk. But at the same time, we should counsel in such a way that the anxiety is not provoked in the women. But the usual advice after screen test negative is to avoid amniocentesis and carry on with the pregnancy. The other scenario is screen positive. If it comes in positive, then what not to do is most important than what to do. What not to do is not to terminate the pregnancy. We see in many cases, especially in rural setups, where people are not very conversant with the screening protocols, if the screen comes as positive, they automatically think that this is a case of Down syndrome, and therefore they advise termination of pregnancy, and woman and the husband and the parents and the family people are so convinced that it is an abnormal baby that they don't want to go for any other further testing. So this is a lack of awareness which we have to clear up, and we should not terminate the pregnancy. The other scenario also, it comes once in a while that we repeat another screening test. If the first screening test has come as positive, we somehow don't try to accept that, it's in the denial phase, and we repeat another screening test and maybe from another center and try to verify whether the first screening test was correct or not. But that is again something which is better avoided. Any screening, we have to understand, is just a screening test. And the second screening test report, whether it has come negative, I mean low risk or not, does not refute that the first one was wrong. It only adds to the confusion. But because both are saying that one is screen positive and screen negative, none of them are confirmatory. And if we believe one over the other, it's only adding to confusion, and it might have medical legal consequences as well. For example, if we have a screening test and it comes as positive, we don't believe that, or we want to verify, we do a second test and the screen test comes as negative. And so we believe the second test and we don't go for a confirmatory test or amniocentesis. And unfortunately, suppose a Down's baby is born, then the first thing that people will say that why didn't you believe the first test? So that is the medical legal consequences which we should be very careful. But sometimes we see, and obviously it is done, that the first screening test has not been done properly, which means the CRL has not been measured. It was an LMP-based screening, or the situation was not right, whatever, or the NT has not been measured properly. What about a situation where the first screening has not been done properly? This is a very tricky situation. It's a very practical problem. There's no clear-cut guideline on that. Majority would say that to discuss with the patient that the first screening test was not done properly, better do a second screening test. But the patient might go back to the first center and say that, oh, this thing has happened. So there are all very tricky questions, medico-legally potent questions. So nobody can actually give a guidance on what to do that. So an individualization of the patient is required. Now, suppose we see that the screen test is positive. What not to do now that you have understood? We need to know what to do. The first of all, we have to counsel that the screen positive test does not mean that the baby is Down's baby. And we should not terminate at this stage, and confirmation is required. Now, how do we proceed from there? After a screen positive test, we basically have three options. One is to go for CVS. The other one is to go for amniocentesis, and the third is to go for a test which is called NIPS, or non-invasive prenatal screening. Now, CVS is a, sorry, the video is not working. The CVS is basically a procedure where under ultrasound guidance, we put in a needle and take a little sample from the placental tissue and send it for analysis. But this chorionuclear sampling is usually not advocated for Down syndrome because it has a slightly higher miscarriage rate of around 1%. The chance of Down syndrome is usually less than that. For example, 1 in 150 or 1 in 200, then the chance of having a miscarriage is more than actually having a Down's baby. And also there is a possibility of confined placental mosaicism, where the genetic chromosomal component of that part of placenta from where the biopsy has been taken could be different from the actual chromosomal pattern of the baby. So even if a Down's baby comes on a placental biopsy, there is a remote possibility of confined placental mosaicism and heterogeneity in the two reports. But CVS is good for thalassemia. Why? Because in thalassemia, the chance of affection of the baby is in the order of 25%. And therefore, we need to detect early for an early termination. So in cases of thalassemia prenatal diagnosis, CVS is the one which is advocated. But usually for Down syndrome confirmatory diagnosis, we would rather wait and do an amniocentesis rather than chorionuclear sampling, unless, of course, the patients are very anxious and you want to go know the report straight away. Now, amniocentesis, when we come, we have two depending on the period of gestation when it is done. One is an early amniocentesis, which is done between 13 and 14 weeks. And the other one is a second trimester standard amniocentesis, which is done after 15 weeks or around 16 weeks to 19 weeks or 20 weeks in our country. Now, early amniocentesis, after a lot of study by Kypros Nikolaidis group, has shown that it is usually not recommended. Why? Because till at that time, there is a presence of extraembryonic xylome, and the amniotic membrane has not fused yet with the decidua. And therefore, after putting in a needle, the needle has to pass through the extraembryonic xylome and then perforate the amniotic membrane and go into the amniotic sac to get the fluid out. Inadvertently, sometimes extraamniotic fluid can be taken out for analysis, which will be a disaster. And in some situations, after taking the needle out, even if it has gone into the amniotic sac, there would be an amniocelomic fistula. And that actually causes leakage of amniotic fluid from the amniotic sac into the extraamniotic xylem and causes a higher rate of miscarriage, 1 to 2%, which is more than CVS. And therefore, if we really have to do an early diagnosis, CVS is much better than an early amniocentesis. In second trimester amniocentesis, sorry, the video is not working. In second trimester amniocentesis, what happens is because the amniotic membrane is already flush with the placenta and the decidua of the uterus, there is no potential space between that membrane and the outer covering. And therefore, if a needle goes in and comes out, there is no fistula formation, and therefore immediately the perforation is plugged and the rate of miscarriage and amniotic fluid leakage is much less. So, and that happens around the age 16 weeks, 15 plus to 16 weeks. So if we have to do an amniocentesis, it is better to do after 15 and a half to 16 weeks. So now, ladies and gentlemen, we have taken out some amniotic fluid under ultrasound guidance, and we have to send it for testing. Now, here we have several types of testing, which can sometimes be very confounding. And then in screen positive women, after counseling the patients into saying what not to do and what to do, and after doing an amniocentesis, now we have to decide which test to perform, either to go for karyotype or to go for QFPCR, which is quantitative fluorescent polymerase chain reaction, or QFPCR, or the FISH, which is fluorescent in situ hybridization, or we have to go for microchromosomal microarray. Now, karyotype is still considered the gold standard of genetics. And when we are talking of genetics here, we are talking about cytogenetics. But this may change in future. There are certain problems with karyotyping which we need to discuss. First of all, for karyotype to take place, we need culture of the cells, which is usually slow. And always there is a possibility of culture failure. It is labor intensive. There can be interpretation error and lots of experience is required. And one person cannot carry on doing karyotype and looking at karyotype because it will cause fatigue. There are some suspicious reports on karyotype, which is really problematic sometimes to sort it out clinically. For example, reporting of satellites, reporting of bending errors, reporting of marker chromosomes, etc., etc. And more importantly, as time is advancing, as research and development is taking place, as we are going into the chromosomes gradually and coming to understand the exons and introns and introns, we cannot detect smaller deletions or duplications by karyotyping, because the banding pattern, the GM subbanding or the G banding as it is called, will not be able to detect smaller deletions and duplications less than 5 megabyte. And these minor micro deletions and duplications all put together would be in the order which put together is more than the incidence of Down syndrome. And therefore, we are looking for Down syndrome and not looking for all these micro deletions, duplications is probably not fair. This is one of the things which are coming up as a major problem of karyotyping. Are we only satisfied with the numerical and the structural type of chromosomal aberrations that we see on karyotype, given all the possibilities of culture failure, interpretation error, labor intensive, and so on? But karyotype is definitely the D test to detect balanced translocations. And it can also detect low-grade mosaicism, which means a percentage of cell lines which is different from the mean cell line. But these two are only possible if we adequate cells are studied, especially low-grade mosaicism. But the clinical question that comes into effect in our mind is whether balanced translocations are important and low-grade mosaicisms are important or not. For example, if there is a balanced translocation, then without any loss or gain of genetic material while the translocations take place, then genotypically there may be abnormality in the karyotype, but phenotypically you can never differentiate between a balanced translocation, perfectly balanced translocation, and a normal person. Like many of us might be actually having a balanced translocation, but balanced translocation comes into importance only when the baby who is born is going to have children again later on when they become mature, and there is a chance of abnormal babies of their generation, the third generation, or recurrent pregnancy loss. In that way, balanced translocations are important. Low-grade mosaicism, for example, Down syndrome babies with mosaicism less than 5%, 4%, or 6%, are they clinically relevant? Are they actually, they should terminate those babies? This is another area of debate, which I'm not going to go into it, because phenotypically, they are almost same as normal. Now, therefore, after karyotype, we have another type of test, which is called a rapid aneuploidy testing. And we have two varieties here, which is the FISH versus QFPCR, quantitative fluorescent polymerase chain reaction. Both are rapid aneuploidy testing, and it is usually done for chromosomes. There are packages given by different companies and associations, etc., validated for 13, 18, 21, and 23. Because I know we are concerned with 21 only because that is the most common chromosomal abnormality causing mental retardation, but it is also common at 13, 18, and 23. So we usually test for all these chromosomes. Now, what is the need for doing this RAT test or rapid aneuploidy testing, either FISH or qRT-PCR? Because they give a quicker result, it causes less anxiety, common aneuploidies are excluded, there's a minimum recall, and there is cheaper. So these are the reasons why RAT tests are done universally all throughout the world. The next, we have to understand the difference between FISH and qRT-PCR. Most of us are aware of the FISH, but very few of us are actually aware of qRT-PCR. And this is a change from cytogenetics to molecular genetics. Karyotype and FISH are basically cytogenetics, but now we are moving into gradually molecular genetics. Sorry, the video is again not working. This video actually showed the quaternary, the secondary, the primary, and in fact, the intelligentary associations of the DNA molecules. As we go into an uncoiling of the DNA molecules, we see that only looking at chromosomes, only looking at the banding is not enough. If we go into the molecule level, we see lots of deletions, lots of duplications, which are not picked up by G-banding, which are not picked up by ordinary karyotype, even with computerized karyotyping. And this can only by the human eye with the aid of a microscope and a computer. Enhancement and resolution. And therefore, there are probes which have been devised which can work at the nano level and pick up these copy number variations and the duplications and the deletions and come to a molecular level. And if we compare now between FISH and qRT-PCR, we see FISH is a single cell analysis. It requires microscope to look at single cells, whereas qRT-PCR is a total DNA analysis. FISH can be carried out not only on fresh amniotic and peripheral blood samples or CVS samples and or not on frozen samples, but in qRT-PCR you can store the DNA sample because the DNA-based test, it is not a chromosome-based test only, and it can be carried out and it can be kept and frozen and can also be done on frozen tissue like decidua, like abortus, etc. In FISH analysis, probes are used which are fluorescently labeled, and they're generally longer than 20 BP, resulting in unspecific binding once in a while, and therefore specificity in hybridization may not be that high. Whereas in qRT-PCR, because there are shorter probes used, the specificity of binding is very high. In FISH, it requires unblocking unspecific DNA, and therefore it requires a DNA blocking procedure to reduce the unspecific binding. And because in qRT-PCR, the primers are very specific, it does not require any blocking step. Regarding signal intensity issues, it also depends on the fluorescent signal which comes up. The resulting signals in FISH are largely variable, resulting in reduced signal intensity, making it impossible to analyze the results, which requires accuracy and a trained eye is very important. In qRT-PCR, there is no signal intensity related issue since it is detected by a laser, not by the human eye. Maximum parameter analysis, it is possible by FISH, but you need to use lots of probes for that and it becomes more and more costly. Whereas in qRT-PCR with a single run, we can just devise which test to do and the automatic results come out because there is no limit for the number of tests which can be done. Time required to process a single sample in FISH is around at least 36 hours because of the hybridization step, and qRT-PCR results can be available within half a day. The multiplexing capacity is limited. As we said, that a single technician can handle about 4 to 8 samples or maximum 10 samples a day. Whereas in qRT-PCR, a single technician can handle up to 100 samples a day because everything is automated. Limitations in resolution, yes, there is in FISH. In qRT-PCR, is not applicable. It relies on fusion signals in FISH because there is no fusion signal problem in qRT-PCR. Haptin-related tissues issues are there in FISH, and simultaneous analysis of multiple abnormalities is unlimited in qRT-PCR, whereas limited in FISH. Ability to detect monosomia chromosome loss is limited in fish. In QAPCR, it is high. Fish suffers from autofluorescence-related false positive issues because of incomplete washing. It is a possibility, which is not applicable here. False monosomy reporting is more, and manual interpretation is there in fish, whereas in QAPCR, it is analyzed by computer. So, ladies and gentlemen, in a nutshell, if we compare the two rat tests, the rapid aneuploidy tests, none of them can detect low-grade mosaicism, but as we discussed, is that clinically relevant? For fish, we need to have at least 100-cell analysis to detect mosaicism, but in majority, some of the commercial available kits, 50-cell analysis is done, although some of them are doing 100-cell analysis. None of them can detect balanced translocation, but again, the question is whether it is clinically relevant. If low-grade balanced translocation without loss or gain of genetic material, and if so, it can be detected by PCR. QFPCR result comes in 48 hours. It is a molecular analysis and it's computerized. Fish is longer time taking, cytogenetics and manual computer aided. But whatever said and done, in addition to rapid aneuploidy testing, it is always advocated we go for a longer testing to know the full range of chromosomes, because we are doing a test anyway. We have two types of tests over here. One is the karyotyping, which is cytogenetics, and we have the chromosome microarray, which looks like this. We are all familiar with the karyotype report, which I've discussed in the first or second slide. And here we have the chromosomal microarray, which looks like that, which we can look at all the chromosomes. But here, only the numerical aberration is detected. It says that it is normal, showing that there is no numerical aberrations detected. But if there is any deletion or duplication, we'll be able to pick up, and then we will be able to report. So that facility is there in microarray. For example, here, this is an abnormal microarray where trisomy 21 has been found out. But important to realize that apart from only the numerical problems, we can also see loss and gain of genetic materials with micro deletions and micro duplications, which is becoming more and more important these days. Now, indications for chromosomal microarray, both the ACOG and the Internet Society for Chromosomal Microarray has shown that it is appropriate to consider indications for chromosome analysis, which now means microarray CGH in overwhelming majority of situation, and more so because of this chromosomal microarray, more and more clinically relevant microdeletion and microduplication syndromes are coming into fore. And in New England Journal of Medicine recently published a paper where they went on to say that if a chromosome analysis is to be done, then chromosomal microarray should be the first choice. The only thing which is blocking us from shifting from karyotype to microarray is the cost. Hopefully, the cost will come down. So now, after screen positive, what to do? We have discussed about the CVS, we have discussed about the amnio, we have discussed about the karyotype, the fish and the QFPCR. And the third thing that is staying with us after the option of having a screen positive test result after FTS or quadruple test or whatever is NIPS or non-invasive prenatal screening. Now, screen positive, if it comes, and if the screen is very highly positive, like more than 1 in 10, then NIPS usually not advocated, because you really need to go for a confirmation. There are women who want a 100% confirmation after screen positive report, because we have to remember that NIPS is still a screening test, though the accuracy is more than 99%, but if the NIPS comes positive, again, the patient has to go through a confirmatory test, which is amniocentesis. This is something which hinders people from choosing NIPS after a screen positive biochemical result. But the cost factor is there with NIPS, but it is coming down. The turnaround time is around 2 weeks. But the important is there is a recall rate. For example, we do a screen test first, like for example, first trimester screening, it comes as screen positive. The woman and the couple choose NIPS, we do NIPS, and the NIPS comes as screen positive. Still, we have to do an amniocentesis, that takes time. But what happens if the NIPS result shows a recall, which means the test needs to be repeated, which happens in 2 to 3% because of low fetal fraction or maternal obesity or low fraction of cell-free DNA. In that case, again, there are two possibilities. Either we go for NIPS again, but there we, it has been seen that the first NIPS is a recall. Usually the second NIPS also suffers from the same factors and is recall again. And there are some studies to show that if NIPS is a recall, there is a possibility of a chromosomal abnormality as well, which we cannot ignore. So it is better to probably go for a confirmatory test like amniocentesis rather than repeating the NIPS again. But in screen positive cases, NIPS is welcome in certain group of patients. For example, who have gone through IVF, where the pregnancy is very precious. They don't want to take that even 0.3% or 0.2% chance of miscarriage following amniocentesis. Women who have recurrent pregnancy loss, they're scared and terrified of needles. Otherwise, also there are some women who are they have a needle phobia and also have a fear of miscarriage. And those patients, all of them, we have to do NIPS in majority of cases, but if they have to be counseled properly that if NIPS comes positive, again, they have to go through a confirmatory test. But majority of these group of patients would probably choose NIPS. So there is a role of NIPS in screen positive women. But then comes a very vexed question that, okay, the screen 21, T21 screen has come positive, and we have done an invasive test, and we have found that the chromosomes are normal. The question is, are we happy? Yes, of course we are happy, but we need to be watchful. Why? Because let us consider this FTS, whether nasal translucency has been done, and we get a report like this, which says a screen positive. Now, this screen positivity could be because of the age alone, because of increased nuchal translucency. It could be because of increased HCG, or it could be because of low PAPI. It could be any of those. And just having screen positive with a normal chromosome is not enough. So if we have a patient who is screen positive and we have done an amniocentesis and we have confirmed the chromosomes are normal, we have to go back to the FTS report again. And we have to find out why is it that it has come as false positive, which was the factor involved, whether it is a high NT or low PAPI. These are the two most important considerations that come to our mind. And there are beautiful papers. There is one, for example, which was published in Ultrasound Obstetrics and Clinical Obstetrics Gynecology by Bilardo et al. Increased nuchal translucency and normal karyotype. Is it time for parental reassurance? Which about 10 years ago, they have shown that more than 80% of patients with normal have a normal karyotype, but with a normal karyotype, but 20% of them do have adverse pregnancy outcome. So nuchal translucency increased with a normal chromosome do have an uneventful adverse pregnancy outcome sometimes. And apart from the trisomies, apart from the aneuploidies, what are the ones which are important? Again, there is another paper which shows that increased nuchal translucency in fetuses with a normal karyotype diagnosis and management an adverse observational study. And it says that although it is a common practice to assume that increased nuchal translucency is an indication for amniocentesis, both literature and results and our study findings indicate that the majority of cases with increased nuchal translucency involve no aneuploidy. So majority of the cases with nuchal translucency are actually not Down syndrome babies. So nuchal translucency with chromosome normal also indicates certain other things. For example, there is a high proportion of cardiac anomalies. So we need to do a proper fetal echocardiography on such patients. There are musculoskeletal abnormalities, and we have to do a very good targeted anomaly scanning around second trimester, and even you can do around a little early. Several genetic syndromes, and in fact the number of genetic syndromes which are associated with increased nuchal translucency with a normal chromosome is increasing day by day. It started with about 3 or 4, now we have at least more than 45-46 several genetic syndromes which can be associated with increased nuchal translucency with normal chromosome. The next factor, for example, here in this particular report, if we go into details, we see this is a patient where the screening test was done, the FTS. The FTS has come as positive. We did a chromosome testing. The chromosome came as normal. And then we went into the report. And what we found, the PAPI was very low, 0.3. And this was the reason, because the rest of them are around 1. So this was the main reason why the FTS has come positive. Now we need to investigate that, is this is high risk pregnancy or not? Of course, this is a high risk pregnancy. So especially if the FTS is positive, chromosome is normal, we have to consider it as a high risk pregnancy. Now, if we go look into the literature, what we see that low PAPI, what are the clinical implications? The implications like that say that the biochemical markers like PAPI can be a useful tool to screen for impaired placentation associated with fetal growth restriction, fetal death in utero, preeclampsia, and abruption. This was something which was published about a few years ago. And in fact, even the Royal College Green Top Guideline, which was published in 2013 and still valid, it says in 5.2 that second trimester Down syndrome markers have limited predictive accuracy for delivery of a small for gestational age neonate. But what has been shown is a low level of PAPA, less than 0.4 mm of the first trimester marker, PAPA should be considered a major risk factor for delivery of ASIA neonate, grade B evidence. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, if T21 comes positive, but chromosomes are normal, then we have to be aware of cardiac anomaly, we have to be aware of musculoskeletal abnormality, we have to be aware of genetic syndromes and take appropriate steps as we have discussed, and also look for fetal growth restrictions later on in pregnancy. So ladies and gentlemen, in summary of saying T21 screen positive, what next? First of all, we do not terminate the pregnancy as such based on the screening report, and also it is better not to do another screening result report. Counseling, we should discuss about options of amniocentesis and NIPS, and of course CVS is also there. We have to talk about the miscarriage rates and the cost involved. We have to discount the RAT test, which is the quantitative fluorescent PCR and FISH alone or with karyotype or chromosomal analysis. It is a move away from cytogenetics to molecular genetics and a move towards QFPCR and chromosomal microarray. But chromosomal microarray is still costly, but it is already been recommended by various authorities as the primary test superseding karyotype in many circumstances, whether there is USG abnormality or not. So after an abnormal amniocentesis report, we counsel for MTP. We only counsel because we cannot advise. There are some women who, even with an abnormal amnio report, would choose to keep a Down's baby. For example, mothers who have come after pregnancy, after 40 years, after long periods of infertility that we see in our practice, they would like to keep any baby anyway. But after a normal report, we should do a careful follow-up depending on the various circumstances of careful looking into the report and take accordingly. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Now that we have finished the thing, we'll be okay to take some questions if there are any. There's a question, so what should be the ideal test with amniofluid to be done for all 23 chromosomes? Yes, at the moment, I think karyotype is the one which is normally advocated and done all over India, at least in our country. In America, of course, they would go for chromosomal microarray. But with gradually reducing cost of chromosomal microarray, I think a day will come, not far away, maybe in 4 years, 5 years' time, I think so, but difficult to predict. Chromosomal microarray could be the first-line testing and replacing karyotype in majority of circumstances, because all the things that you can diagnose on karyotype, like structural, apart from any loss or gain of material, you can diagnose the chromosomal microarray. The only thing which you cannot diagnose and it can only be diagnosed in karyotype is balance translocation, which is really of relevance. Thank you, Atanu. Thank you for your comment. In fact, I've learned a lot from you. Atanu Kumar Dutta is basically a geneticist based in Kolkata. gestational age 21 weeks, Aniruddha De. He has asked a question, a very pertinent question. 21 weeks, is this suitable for NIPT? I think with the condition of 20 weeks MTP in our country, whether if a patient comes at 21 weeks, it's a very tricky situation to NIPT, because you see the NIPT report will come after 2 weeks, at 23 weeks. There is always a possibility of recall, and then you have to do it again. So this is a bit tricky situation. What we can do, of course, is that at 21 weeks you can go for straight away for an invasive testing if it is really desired, if it is really required, and you can get a report within a week or so. And then with the modern ruling of the current ruling of the Supreme Court, you can always refer to a panel in your state and get through for a verdict for termination of pregnancy because of condition of the fetal health up to 24 weeks, which is individualized now, but in days to come it will probably be open. That indication for MTP will be open to 24 weeks, but at the moment everything has to be individualized. But in every state there is a cell which has been formed to look after these situations, and still one can do invasive test for confirmatory around 21 weeks, 22 weeks, so that it can be terminated before 24 weeks, but that is again has to be individualized. If a patient is, Amar Chatterjee has asked a question, if a patient faced 3 abnormal miscarriage before where no karyotyping is done, which test should be done now before conceiving? Of course, you have to go for, you have to look for balanced translocation in the parents, and the balanced translocation can be done with karyotyping. So in these situations, karyotyping is very good. You have to do karyotyping of the parents in recurrent miscarriage. But yes, you can do chromosomal microarray also. But at the moment, the guideline is you have to do to karyotyping of both the parents to see whether they are carrying any balanced translocation. Sana Islam, yes. Been there from the beginning. This is great. Thank you. Post-DNA day, 25th April. I didn't know that. Thank you. It has been Genetics Week in Kolkata and such a promising. Thank you. Thank you, Sana. I hope you had a very good time in Kolkata, and I know you are moving to Dubai. Mr. Uday has asked, what should be the basis for test selection, QFPCR, FISH or KTCMA? Well, as we have discussed before, we need to do one rapid aneuploidy testing, especially in cities and centers where the genetic lab is not present. Because you see, suppose you do in a center where the genetic lab is not there, and you have to send the sample to some other city somewhere, or maybe to Bombay or Kolkata, or somewhere else, or Chennai. In that case, there is a transit there. There is always a possibility of contamination of the sample. There's a possibility of breakage, things like that. And also, there's a possibility of culture failure, temperature, hot, warm, very cold, because the couriers are carrying the sample. And therefore, there is always a possibility of culture failure if you go for karyotype. There is always a 1 to 1% or so chance. So we always would like to go for a rapid aneuploidy testing. So you go for FISH or karyotype. But as we said, that FISH or QFPCR depends on various other situations. And more people are probably moving into PCR. Regarding KT and CMA, of course, CMA is better, but because of price factor, CMAs are becoming more difficult to do. But gradually over time, it will come down, and probably in that case, CMA will be done. If a family can afford NIPS, should biochemical screen be avoided? Yes, if you are only doing for Down syndrome, there is nothing there in comparison with NIPS with such sensitivity and specificity. With whatever biochemical screening you do, even with the newly introduced penta screening, it will not be able to match NIPS. So if you only want to know about Down syndrome and about nothing else, then NIPS is probably the best. But the question is that along with biochemical testing, apart from the cost factor of NIPS, in biochemical testing, we are doing an ultrasound scan. And in ultrasound scan, we can rule out major abnormalities, which is present to about 0.5 to 1% cases between 11 and 14 weeks. And we can see lots of other things. We can do the nuchal translucency. We look at all the major abnormalities can be excluded, like holoprosencephaly, allobar holoprosencephaly, your umbilical hernia, gastroschisis, absent limbs, sacral agenesis, megacystis. So these are the things which can be picked up on early anomaly scan. And these are always picked up on early anomaly scan. I'm not talking about subtle abnormalities. That advantage is there. And we do the nuchal translucency. And because of these factors, I think that is because of the thing that it will not exactly replace. Because with the biochemical screening, we can also go for trisomy 18, trisomy 13, and lots of other abnormalities. Now, NIPS, what was the next question? For POC, which test should be better? QFPC or Fisher? For POC, either you go for karyotype or you should go for microarray, because karyotype, it will not grow very well. So microarray is the one, or you can go for QFPCR. Fish, you may go, but karyotyping in majority of cases would fail in POC. That's what we see. And therefore, in POC, karyotype, which requires cell culture, is usually avoided. We should go for molecular testing. If double testing BCA above cutoff, if the double test beta HCG range is above cutoff, can we consider it to be positive in double marker or combined screening? If yes, what can we further test to be done for diagnosis? Yes, sometimes FTS comes positive because of a high beta HCG, which is very rare, because beta HCG as such is a very poor marker for Down syndrome. The most important one is PAPA and nuchal translucency. But beta HCG is there, it does help. Now, if the beta HCG is high, we have to think about molar changes in the placenta, partial mole, for example. We have to think of hyperluteinized ovaries, especially in IVF pregnancy, where beta HCG is increased because of luteinization, hyperstimulation of the ovaries, apart from exogenous beta HCG. This is apart from exogenous beta HCG. Endogenous beta HCG is also raised. These are the situations, and if beta HCG is raised, there is some evidence that it can be associated with high blood pressure later on in pregnancy. Now, Oyon has asked where chromosomal microarray is done in Kolkata and what is the cost. Okay, cost you have to ask the companies. So different companies give in different ranges. I think it will be range of around 15 or so. Where it is done, yes, you can send to different centers and they will do chromosomal microarray. If double test beta HCG is above that, we have discussed. So can you prefer NIPT at this point of time? Yes, as I said, you can rely on NIPT as a primary screening of Down syndrome. There's nothing like it. But the question is, do we want to screen for Down syndrome only? We have to do an ultrastructural scan. We have to do an early anatomy scan. That is beyond question. And we pick up so many things on early anatomy scan. We can look at nuchal translucency also. I'm not going to tell you that you have to do intracranial translucency in all patients. That will unnecessarily increase your time. But you can eyeball the fetus. And that is very important. Can we do a quadruple marker, a triple marker with gestational age 21 weeks or more? Again, the same question. That you see, if you're really bothered about confirmation of chromosomal status of the baby after 21 weeks, then we should ideally go for a straightaway confirmatory test, if at all. It can be done. There are questions which comes to many people's mind. We cannot do an invasive test after 20 weeks. After having attended lots of seminars in the Forum of Society of Fetal Medicine, etc., I have come to know that it is possible to do invasive test after 20 weeks, provided you get the report, and if a decision has to be taken for termination of pregnancy, it can be done before 24 weeks. But for that, individualization is important. We cannot just do it just like that. We have to send it to the panel, get an approval with the sitting judge, and all that is all there in every state. It has been constituted by the center, and it can be done to save the parents. What is the utility of detection rate and sensitivity for biochemical markers in the assay? Yes, as we said, for example, with penta screening, let us talk about the penta screening, which is coming being gradually introduced. We see if we can do a penta screening with nuchal translucency, without nuchal translucency. If we put a cutoff range of 1 in 300, then without nuchal translucency, the sensitivity of the penta screening is around 92-93%, which is very, very high, without even nuchal translucency. And this is from Kypros Nikolaidis figure, and with a false positive rate of 1.2%. And if we do nuchal translucency along with pentest screening combined together, then we have a detection rate of 98%, which is almost coming to nuchal translucency, which is almost coming to your NIPS. So there is one genetic screening, which is NIPS, and there is biochemical screening, of which we know the triple test, quadruple test, FTS, and now the pentest screening. Now, if we come to trisomy 18 and trisomy 13, then without nuchal translucency, the sensitivity with a false positive rate of 1.2% is around 88%, approaching 90. And if we include nuchal translucency, it comes to 95%. So it's all in the range of above 90%. And even sometimes without nuchal translucency, I'm not saying, not against doing an early anatomy scan. We should do an early scan between 11 to 14 weeks because it shows so many other things. And it can also be used for preeclampsia, like in pentest screening and first trimester quadruple screening. What happens is the PLGF is included. And in the PLGF, you get a recalculation for early onset preeclampsia. And this is quite significant. And it does not show so much about late onset preeclampsia, but early onset severe preeclampsia is the one which you are bothered about. And that is what is killing disease for mothers. And it has been shown that if we give less than 16 weeks low dose aspirin, 150 milligram, it does help. It significantly reduces the incidence of preeclampsia and helps us to tide over the gestation period. So there are ifs and buts of NIPS and biochemical testing. If NIPS is good for only Down syndrome screening, less so for 18 and 13. So if somebody is bothered only about Down syndrome screening, NIPS is the best. The question is whether we are doing only Down syndrome or a lot of other things. If PAPE beta is aniruddha, if PAPE beta ECG AFP PLGF inhibin A, that is the dimeric inhibin A, are AFTS, then what we consider as a substitute of NIPT. We should not consider as a substitute of NIPT. We should give a cafeteria of choice to the patients, basically, because we have to tell them that these are the things which are existing, these are the costs involved, these are the pros and cons, which we have discussed in such a details today. And then ultimately, it's the parents who have to decide, and it's our role is to guide them towards either going for genetic screening like NIPS or go for the biochemical screening. If you are going for the biochemical screening, obviously first trimester screening is best. Either you go for FTS, first trimester quarter, recently introduced first trimester pentest screening, or if this window is missed between 11 and 14 weeks, still we have to offer some screening tests to the woman. Then we, of course, have the quadruple test in the second trimester. One thing we should be avoiding is the triple test because it has such a low sensitivity and specificity with a high rate of amniocentesis. I think triple test is better avoided. Shandipan, apart from looking from genetic syndromes and for risk assessment in markers and NT, shall we also look for uterine Doppler? Yes, if possible, you look for uterine Doppler. The whole question is cost effectiveness. You see, we cannot carry on doing an FTS for 40 minutes. That is something which is illogical. Yes, you could do it in highly tertiary centers for research purposes and etc. etc. But in Indian population, if you're talking about tertiary centers doing a limited number of scans and charging high for the scans, that is okay. You have to keep the best. But here we are here to pick up Down syndrome, to pick up early preeclampsia. In those situations, of course, we can do with improving scanning machines, we can see a lot of things. But I think we have to cut a standard somewhere, and as I normally tell my students, that it is better to follow the ISWOG guideline. The ISWOG guideline, the International Society for Obstetrics and Gynecological Ultrasound, which has clearly mentioned what are the structures to be seen routinely in first trimester scan. If we follow that, I think that would be the best thing that we can do. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think we had a very healthy discussion. I think we have been able to clarify some of the doubts and some of the things which go around the Down syndrome screening. What are the things that we should screen for? What are the things we should be doing once the screen test comes positive? Because as soon as the screen test comes positive, there is a lot of anxiety among the parents and a lot of anxiety among the relatives. And they almost take it for granted that the baby is abnormal. It is our responsibility to offer screening services, to do the proper screening services, to do the proper thing with the most accuracy, with the utmost care. So there is minimum false positive positivity, less chance of amniocentesis, and high chance of pickup of Down syndrome. And with these few words, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening again.